Welcome to Phonogenics 101. My name is Jeremy Gloff. I am your host. Tonight we are going to be delving into the discography of Joni Mitchell. Make sure to like the YouTube page, Phonogenics 101. If you'd like to support this podcast, I have a Patreon, Patreon.com/Jeremy Gloff. And before I introduce the panel, let me start off by going into a little bit about my journey with Joni Mitchell. I actually came into Joni Mitchell's music through Prince. I was a huge Prince fan in middle school. On the back of his Controversy album, it said Joni on a newspaper. And then on his Sign of the Times album, he had a song called Ballad of Dorothy Parker, where he lifts one line from the song, Help Me. I was in my parents' car in seventh grade, and I heard the real Help Me on the radio. I'm like, this is the song from the Joni Mitchell or the Prince song. So I was at a flea market with my mom, and I was going through the vinyls, and I found the Chalk Mark in a Rainstorm vinyl. So the first thing I ever bought from Joni Mitchell was Chalk Mark in a Rainstorm. I never heard Blue anything from her. So that was my starting point, which I think probably to you guys is like, what a weird place to start.
That's a real rough start, yeah.
How young are you?
I'm 40. I just turned 46.
Okay.
Yeah. So A Night Ride Home was the first Joni Mitchell album I got to experience as a fan new release. I'll just say one more thing. I had this book, the New Rolling Stone Record Guide. As a kid, I just read it because I loved music. And I was so intrigued by all the Joni Mitchell album titles. I used to write all the titles on my notebook in middle school. And I knew them all by heart before I heard one note of the music. So I bought Chalk Mark in a Rainstorm. I went to a record store, and I think I bought Blue, Court and Spark, and maybe Don Juan's Reckless Daughter. And that would have been 1989, 1990. And, you know, I've been a huge fan ever since then. So let's go around the list. And if everyone wants to introduce themselves and tell a little bit about their history with Joni, let's start with Bob.
Yeah, well, I'm a little bit older than you. I've been into Joni Mitchell. Basically, I think the first album I bought was Ladies of the Canyon. Great album. Every song was great on that. And then once I got that, I went back a little bit. I think the one with the self-portrait was Songs of Seagulls, if I remember correctly. And ever since that, you know, I've been a big fan of hers through James Taylor, Blue, her jazz albums, kind of like tailed off with when she really got deep into it. I kind of tailed off music altogether in that period of time because I was married and raising a family and music kind of like died. Since I've retired, music has become more important.
Awesome. And I realize we have two Bobs, so I guess I'll call Bob M.
Okay. So, Bob M., my first reel, when I really dove into Joni was with Help Me, the hit she had. Really, her only one top 10 hit that she's ever had. She released a hits CD. Matter of fact, this was the little advertising thing for it.
Oh, I love that.
So she only had one top 10 hit. She had some other singles, obviously. Nothing else that really broke for her. Help Me was the zeitgeist of pop music and the kind of upcoming jazz sound. And it was just so refreshing on the radio. I remember Midnight at the Oasis by Maria Muldaur came out pretty much the same time. They played those songs back to back. And I loved them and I bought the album. And of course, Help Me is just one jewel in a crown of amazing songs, which has a flow, a logical flow from start to finish. It has, of course, a tribute to Lambert, Hendricks, and Ross with Twisted. And then it has Down to You, which is just one of my second or third most favorite songs from her. Luckily I was raised by my father, who was a big music fan. He loved Broadway. He loved lyrics. And so we would sit down and listen to lyrics. So I got to where I'd hear a song and really listen to the lyrics. So I bought that album, and like all of her albums, they were all gatefolds, all the lyrics printed inside.
Right.
You could read it like a book while you listened. And when I looked it Down to You, of course, I was 17 years old, so I didn't understand a lot of it.
Right.
But I knew it was great, and it sounded great. I mean, that sound of that album is just awesome. Then it wasn't until of course, Hissing of Summer Lawns, 75, that was also brilliant. And then Hajira came out. And when that record came out, I was just blown away. I didn't understand hardly any of it. I just knew it was very, very important. And the more life experience I got, the more I could begin to understand it. And that's been the case. And to this day, I'll listen to it and it still opens up and reveals something to me that I had not heard before.
Yeah, that's the thing about Joni's music is there's a line that maybe escaped you all these years. Then all of a sudden you'll be at an intersection in your life where the lyric makes sense for the first time. And she says things in a way that only she can say things.
Oh yeah.
So
yeah.
All right. So cool. Well, we're so glad to have you, Dan.
I live in Minneapolis. And grew up in Minnesota, but I lived in Colorado when I first got involved in the discussion list. Bob, you sent me a bunch of CDs a long time ago. Thank you.
I remember it's been a long time, so it's nice to see you. We're sort of in the dark.
I don't often write stuff, but I generally read the digest every night. But anyway, as a child, I must have been like 12 or 13 when I first heard Joni Mitchell, and it was Song to a Seagull that my sister was playing in her bedroom, you know, and I heard it through the door, like Michael from Mountains seemed to be the first thing that struck me. And I've been a huge fan ever since. I'm a guitarist and a piano player, and I've played a bunch of her songs on piano. You know, I've just picked up on them, being able to play them. They're very easy for a hack piano player to play. Not to say that they're, not significant, certainly. But I always resisted trying to play her stuff on guitar because I resisted the tunings. I
just 51 tunings or however many she has?
A bunch.
Yeah. And I just always resisted it. And now, like 2 months ago, I started tuning to her tunings and learning the songs off the transcriptions on the website. And I'm just plowing through all of the ones that I like the guitar parts of. And when this COVID thing is over, my sister and I are going to try to form a duo where I play guitar and she sings.
Nice.
Throughout my life, she's been a constant soundtrack item, obviously. I'm 64 now.
Okay. We're about to be joined by Pearl also. Mark, would you like to introduce yourself and say a little bit about your journey with Joni?
Yeah. I'm Mark Scott. I, like Bob, I came on with Court and Spark. And I had heard Twisted covered by Bette Midler, which, of course, is a totally different take on the song. And a couple of other things. And I bought the album, and the lyrics just blew me away. That was the first thing that really drew me to her, was like, I thought she was reading my own thoughts and my own feelings. I'm going, how the hell is she doing this? How does she know how I feel? You know? And so I started buying her back catalog, and I went, I think the first one I bought was Clouds, and I'm like, this doesn't sound a damn thing like Court and Spark. And so I sort of was fascinated by the fact that none of these records sounded exactly the same. It was the same artist, obviously the same person, the same persona, the same kind of mindset, but musically they were, and the production, it was all different. And she was exploring something with each new record. And that really, I think, hooked me. It was like, and each one was great in its own way. And so each subsequent album, even though I didn't necessarily, like Bob, I didn't necessarily get them at first, but I stuck with them because there was always something there, something intriguing, something that was worth digging into. And I like Bob too, after all of these years, and this was in the 70s, and I'm still finding new things when I listen to some of her records, and I've stuck with her ever since.
I feel like we're gonna have just so much fun going through all the albums. There's so many memories that are probably tied to this music with all of us. Before I introduce you, Pearl, I'm just going to give a little background. I came into Joni with Chalk Mark and a Rainstorm, and I'm kind of a pop. Like, I love Madonna, Lady Gaga, but I really love Joni Mitchell. So I'm probably in a very big minority where I love Dog Eat Dog, and I didn't love the orchestra albums very much. So it's interesting how everyone's going to kind of have their own opinion as we go through this discography. Pearl, would you like to introduce yourself and kind of say how you came into Joni Mitchell? I think you're on
mute. You're on mute. Pearl's down in Florida.
Unmute.
I'm in Florida too. I'm in Tampa.
I'm in Hollywood, near awesome. Fort Lauderdale, Miami.
You looking good, sweetheart?
Okay. Hi, Bob. Okay. Did I unmute myself? I'm okay.
Yep.
Okay. Good. I got into it by a friend of mine and I, when we were in maybe 10th grade, decided to take guitar lessons, and we took. It was another, like a senior. He was giving lessons, and he was teaching the two of us. And the four songbooks that he gave us was Peter, Paul, and Mary, Simon and Garfunkel, Judy Collins, and Joni Mitchell. And he got us the songbook, the one that had a lot of her unreleased stuff. And I fell in love with it then. It ruined them. I was really good in 9th grade. In 10th grade, I wasn't so good anymore. No, it was 10th grade, I was good. 11th grade, all I did was practice guitar. I would sit in the on the floor, and there was a big mirror, and my grades like plummeted from 90s to 70s in math. But I would just learn how to play all of them, but Joni in particular. And even to the point where I did a few little shows and stuff as Joni, speaking, making believe I was her, and my hair was long. Maybe I looked a little bit like her at the time. But no, since then, and this is going back to the first album, to 68, and even with my later to be husband, it was kind of a blind date that his father did my taxes and drove me home. I didn't have a car at the time, and it was three buses in New York, and so anyway, when he did call me for the date or to talk to me, in the background, he was playing Court and Spark.
Aww.
Now, we never talked. I didn't know him. He didn't know me. For some reason, he just connected that chicks like that or something. and we've been together for 40 some years now.
That's so wonderful. Oh my gosh. All right.
Spark.
Yeah, right. Well, we are about to delve into the discography of Joni Mitchell, track by track, album by album. And what a mammoth task we have ahead of us.
Oh, my God.
I'm going to do one Joni album a month with different groups of people. I'm also going through Stevie Nicks, Madonna, and Prince. So this is the Joni Mitchell crew right here. We're starting. I got my little Song to a Seagull CD right there. It's interesting because in some discography lists, they list this just as being called Joni Mitchell. So does anyone know why they call it both? Or is that just a misprint?
Oh, the painting on the cover says Song to a Seagull.
Yeah.
Nobody really sees it as words.
Okay.
Has anybody ever really solved that, Bob, as to what she intended the album to be called in the beginning?
She intended it to be called Song to a Seagull. I think the spine on the vinyl said Joni Mitchell.
Yeah, it does.
Oh.
And maybe that was a conscious effort on the record company to help identify who this new artist was. But It's definitely supposed to be Song to a Seagull and not Joni Mitchell.
Okay. It's interesting because recently the archive box set has come out, and we got to hear a lot of the really early versions of these songs as they got written. What's interesting that is a starting point of Joni Mitchell's career. I find the production of this album is unlike any other Joni Mitchell album. Don't you all agree?
Yeah. It was, I mean, she said it's been recorded under under a bell jar.
Yeah.
She didn't want to be produced. So she talked Crosby into being her producer, quote unquote. So the record company would buy into that because he was a known entity at the time.
Right.
So he's a producer, but he basically, you know, didn't do much. They recruited, of course, Stephen Stills to do right. bass lines on Night in the City. But for the most part, the record's all her. Whatever techniques he used or didn't know not to use resulted in a real muffled sound. And I wish Dave Blackburn, a good friend of ours who lives in California, mm-hmm. who's a master sound engineer, has taken this recording and redone it to clean it up. And it really okay. sounds nice and clean.
Because, yeah, the album is very eerie, like airy.
Yeah. What I understand is that David Crosby had Joni singing to the piano strings at some point. And because of this, it did something to the mic that the master tape did not sound the way it should at all. And so wow. he or somebody tried to do something to fix it. And it didn't really work very well. Like you said, it has a very eerie sound to it, which I actually kind of like. But it has this kind of, I don't know, haunted sound to it, to me, which suits the material. But
it's talking about how out of the city and into the seaside, I feel like the music almost is like an ocean spray. Like it's very yep. misty.
Good point. And I was actually late coming to this record, you know, when I didn't like the Joni, you know, would be hits like Chelsea Morning and things I heard on the radio. I didn't like what she refers to as her helium voice, that really right. high voice. So I was not a fan until Court and Spark. Well, that really hit me. So, and it wasn't until I joined the Joni Mitchell discussion list in 98 and I realized, okay, I need to go back and get, I'd already heard Clouds, I'd had Blue, I right. had not had Ladies of the Canyon. So I had to go back and get Song to a Seagull in 98 as well as Ladies of the Canyon so I could orient with those records and learn those songs. So I, you know, that was 20 years ago. So I've obviously spent a lot of time with him since. But the most thing that interested me was how she would, on some of these songs, maybe I'm ahead of myself here, but on some of these songs, she would dip into this low register.
Oh,
that
yeah.
I didn't even know yeah. she had, you know?
Now this record, to me, her voice doesn't sound like this on any of her other albums as it did on this first one. And, where was I going with this? Sorry. It has a whole different sound.
Whoa.
There are some very interesting tapes of Joni Mitchell, early Joni Mitchell, before she did any albums. She was in this Canadian folk show. I forgot the name of it, but
The Way It Is was the next one. The Way It Is was a TV show.
Let's see.
Some promotional videos where she was out in the nature with cows running behind her while she's singing.
Right.
She was also on some thing called Let's Sing Out with Oscar Brand.
Yeah, Let's Sing Out.
She was really a folky, and it kind of paralleled, you know, like Simon and Garfunkel and into Paul Simon, the way the music developed. You listen to Simon Garfunkel, very simple guitar and not much production.
I love that Joni denied being a folky until this year. Like finally, last year, 2020, she's like, actually, I was a folky.
Yeah, when the archives came out, she was busted.
That's why we love our Joni, right? So what's interesting about this album is the cover's very, a lot of curly cues, very ornate. I feel the music's the same way, which makes this album unique because I think with Clouds, with her music and her artwork, she really pared it down a lot. So this very album is so. Very unique in its like kind of like frilliness. Do you all agree a little bit maybe?
Yeah.
Somewhat. Yeah, and just to talk a little bit about the album art, this was a style that she worked in. She didn't really know where she was going artistically, She would start in the corner of her paper or whatever she was drawing on, and just start going from one corner to the other, drawing and creating along the way. And that's what this album cover was.
Right. Well, I think the album cover art is also very much of the time.
Oh yeah.
Oh sure.
It's the flower child era.
It has like that photo with like the fish lens on it.
Right.
Yeah.
A documentary on her basically said that she started singing and writing songs to make money to support her art. That her first love was really her art. But then it just blossomed into it being a primary focus.
I think it's interesting. I feel like Joni Mitchell, like even through like the 90s, she's like, I'm actually an artist. Like I do music, but really I'm an artist.
Well, and she's an amazing artist, right? I mean, you have lots of musicians who dabble in art, but there's nobody who's going to look at a Dylan piece and say, that's really great art. You know,
right.
You should have given up songwriting and become an artist. Whereas with Joni, it's like, she is an incredible artist, you know, recognized worldwide.
Yeah. Before we go into the first track, wasn't there like a Florida, speaking of Hollywood, Florida, wasn't there a Florida connection with this album where she met Dave Crosby?
Yes.
There was Gulfstream Racetrack, which is a couple of miles from my house.
Really?
Yeah. But that's before I moved here. I'm originally from New York, so okay. It was a bit before I moved to, a few years. But yeah, they were at they had concerts there and stuff. And so I think she performed there at Gulfstream.
Yeah, she was playing in a small club in Florida, and Crosby just happened to wander in to the club and hear her. And, you know, it was love at first listen as far as what he heard. And he took her out on his boat, which that was where the Dawn Treader, that song comes from.
Okay.
Yeah.
Is it Coconut Grove? Is that,
that sounds right.
Okay.
Yes. Coconut Grove.
Cool. Well, the album is, this was back when there was vinyl, so split into two sides. I came to the city and out of the city down to the seaside. And it's interesting because Joni had such a big repertoire even before this first album. So I feel a lot of the songs she chose for this first album maybe got chosen because it fit the theme of the album more than them being maybe her best songs. Even though there's a lot, like I love every song on here, don't get me wrong. So the first track is I Had a King, obviously talking about her marriage. And would anyone like to talk about this song? I'll let you guys take it away. Then I'll jump in.
Well, yeah, I mean, it's very much about Chuck Mitchell and their marriage and the time they spent in Detroit. The salt rusted carriage was a little sports car that he drove around in that was salt rusted because they were driving out in Michigan. Having lived in Michigan, you know, in the wintertime, they have to salt the roads to keep all the snow and ice melted. So, you know, and they were of different styles. And I know Chuck, you know. Uh-huh. Full disclosure, I've met him and we've hung out and we're friends. And he's a great guy. He doesn't hold any grudges about some of the bad stuff that's been printed about him.
Sure.
He has some different stories. This obviously is just straight to what happened. You know, she actually had to escape in the middle of the night in this little apartment in Detroit. They actually had Motown players that would come out and jam with them. And they just watched Joni play the guitar because of her alternate tunings.
Right.
You know, they just watch in amazement. So it was a real interesting blend of, I just can imagine these Motown players hanging out with Chuck and Joni. And his songwriting was all, you know, sings of what, ladies and wine and woe. He was all old folk songs.
Sure.
Whereas she was a whole different style. And they did a lot of songs together as a duo, but they would split up. He'd do a set and she'd do a set. And he quickly found out that she was much more popular than he was, you know, for many reasons.
In their tenement castle, right?
There might have been a third floor walk up in Detroit. So that was their tenement castle, yeah. And I think Sheila Weller wrote in her book, too, that Chuck changed all the locks on the doors. I don't know if Chuck has confirmed that or not. So I can't go back there anymore. I know my don't fit the door.
Yeah.
So even from the first song on the first Joni album, like she's writing so personal with right into the details of what's going on.
Malcolm Arome talks about seeing her when she first met her in a coffee house in Toronto, and she was singing I Had a King, and Malka was thinking that she was going to get a divorce at the time. She wrote a book. I don't know if you're familiar with her or not, Jeremy, are you? Who Malka Marome is?
Yeah.
She was interviewed in the documentary.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. She published a book, Joni Mitchell, in her own words. And
I've read that book. Wonderful.
Pretty extensive interviews with her. But she saw her in this coffee house, and that was how they met. And she was singing I Had a King, and it just hit her in the chest, you know, that this is incredible music, and it's also speaking directly to me, so.
Yeah. Does anyone have any thoughts on I Had a King before we move on to the second song?
I love the guitar work in the song. I love the guitar work in the whole album, but
mm-hmm.
when she
said, it's a beautiful song. I'm sorry, go ahead.
I can't go back there anymore. Doom, 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 doom. The way the guitar, it's orchestral, and it's really beautiful. I really like it.
Well, it was funny. You know, I talked about not coming to this record until the late 90s. When I first heard, I put the CD in and played it. It's like, oh my gosh, I realized that this rap group that I was really a big fan of, PM Dawn.
Oh yeah.
In the 80s, they sampled this song.
I remember that.
Yeah,
I didn't know
they
that.
Sampled it. So I when I started either. Hearing her play, I said, wow, that's the song that PM Dawn sampled. And of course, they were huge Joni fans. They had several Joni references, like Prince. They had several Joni references in their music. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's that. And
the last note of the song, like, they never can. Like, it isn't in that soprano. It is kind of a little bit of a lower register. And someone had mentioned that earlier.
Yeah, the one that blew me away was when she says brown. They're painting the pastel walls brown. You know, she's way down on that. I'd not heard that nose notes before, you know. And so it really blew me away. I remember, matter of fact, I'm at my home now. I was right out there in my driveway getting ready to leave for work when I put the CD in and heard it. I said, oh my God, I never heard Joni sing that note before. You know,
I never can. Yeah.
like we said, how the music's very, it's almost like you can see the rain falling when all this is happening. The song is just so atmospheric. So any other thoughts on I Had a King before we move on? Bob One or Pearl, any thoughts? I don't want to skip anybody.
Oh, okay.
There's been some interesting covers of it. You know, I've run the cover section of Joni's website.
Okay.
So for about the past 20 years, I've been keeping track of and actually collecting all these recordings of Joni Mitchell covers. And it's been a really, really strange journey.
That can be hit or miss, right?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. There's some great stuff. And there's, you know, some stuff that obviously you try to do a Joni song. The odds are you're not going to do it as good as her. You know, there's some that I would say compete, some that make it their own. If you just try to do it like she does, okay, it's not going to stand up as well.
Sure.
But it's this song has been recorded by Irma Schultz, recorded it in Swedish language. Most notably, it was recorded fairly early on by Joshua Redman, the jazz pianist, who put his own spin on it. It's been recorded about 40 times. So it's been a real, real popular song. And you know, mostly jazz artists are covering her music, which I think is really a tribute to the fact that, okay, in 1968, she was not really a folkie, you know, maybe 64, 65.
Sure.
She's doing folk covers like we heard on the archives. But by the time she's writing songs and recording her own music, yeah, she's sitting there playing the guitar. But it's not folk music. It's much more complex than that.
My favorite Joni Mitchell cover of all time, which y'all may laugh at me, but I loved Janet Jackson's version of Beat of Black Wings.
Oh, yeah.
I thought it was just brilliant. Amazing. And all right. So track number two, Michael from Mountains. What do we all think of this one?
Well, it made me look up what taffeta is. She had a tremendous vocabulary.
Yeah.
It's got some beautiful imagery in it. I think that's a good example of a song that she's embroidered a lot
Right.
Words on a lot of descriptive phrases and adjectives and.
Well, and even that, you know, the taffeta references, oil in the puddles in taffeta patterns, which brilliant wordplay. It's one of those lines that nobody but Joni is going to write.
Right.
And we've all, you know, even when you were a kid, I remember you see oil, you know, some oil in water, and it makes these beautiful little mini rainbows, you know, on the ground. And you just look at it and say, you know, that's oil. It's not, I'm not happy that it's on the ground, but it's beautiful, you know?
It's not a good thing, but it is beautiful.
Yeah.
Every time I see that in the street, I think about that song.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
The one I like is yellow slickers up on swings, like puppets on strings hanging in the sky.
Yeah.
These kids in the yellow raincoat swing in the rain.
I will admit, like, when I was getting into Joni Mitchell's music, I always had a dictionary nearby because there's always, like, one or two words that I didn't know what they meant. She has such a beautiful vocabulary.
You know, that's the dedication on the album to Mr. Kratzman, who taught me.
I love words. What he was going to say.
Right. My cam doesn't want to work. Keeps
technology,
going.
Right? Was there an actual Michael?
I have not heard Mark or Pearl if there's an actual person.
I don't know. I don't know.
There's somebody on the archive set that she made a couple of tapes for, or one tape. And I wondered who that referred to. I don't think it was Michael, though.
And what a treat that archive set was.
I
took a trip Michael to Orlando. Oh, okay. All right, so then.
And I don't know who that is.
We're like, are you the Michael?
Mm-hmm. Well, on that song, is she is singing in the helium voice.
Yes.
A lot of it.
Right.
That's definitely a helium voice song.
But well, I think there's another one that was introduced to people by Judy Collins, you know, the same time she introduced Both Sides
Yes.
Now.
Mm-hmm.
On the Wildflowers album, yes.
Right.
Yes.
All right, so then we move into track three, which is still one of my favorite Joni Mitchell songs. I remember I was in high school, and I'm from Western New York. I live in Tampa now, but I grew up on Lake Erie, and the winters were always terrible, but there was that first day when the snow started to melt, and you could open your window. I remember playing Night in the City the first day, like, the spring air came in at night. I always look back as like, just one of the most peaceful, best moments of my life. And that song, like, the bass line, it still jams. Oh. Like, I'd love...
I always assumed that was about New York, but on the archive...
Whoa, Mark.
Oh, we lost Mark again. Hold that.
It's about Toronto, I think.
Ah.
Okay.
It's my least favorite song on that album.
Really? How come?
All the extra instrumentation. I don't like.
So it feels a little excessive?
Yeah, and you know, the bass is really ordinary and loud. You know,
yeah. It is very loud when the bass comes in. It's like, do-do-do-do-do-do, like.
There was some question as to whether it was Joni playing piano in that song.
Right.
She doesn't play any piano on any of her albums until Ladies of the Canyon, because she never had a piano. She was living in these apartments. She had guitars. And then all of a sudden, she's living with Graham Nash, and they have a piano. And then all of a sudden, she invents a style of piano.
I feel like the piano on Night in the City doesn't sound like piano on any other Joni Mitchell song.
It does not. And if it is her, it's because she hasn't had any chance to learn how to develop a style.
Right.
And I never thought it sounded much like her style either, but someone had to remind her that the album credit says it's Joni.
It does say that. But it's really instills style of playing.
Right.
Blues. You know, basic blues and dominant seventh chords, if I'm losing anybody.
I was looking on the archive box set, and that's the earliest of these songs, I think, that's on there. It's from 1966, and I think she sang it on Let's Sing Out.
I feel like it grooves a little bit differently in those early live versions. It had a little bit different of a pattern, I felt like.
Well, and what's funny about it is she went in this early, and I've got several live versions of her with the song before it was recorded, and she was trying to make it a sing-along with the audience. Well, you know, you can sing along with Circle Game. That chorus is fairly easy to sing. Yeah. Night in the city looks pretty to me. No, that's never going to be a sing-along for anybody.
No.
And, of course, the recording has the album has the echo there on the chorus. So,
which I always sing along to in my car. I always did the echo when I was in my car. I probably still do.
I do it with the archive. I try to.
I'm going to try that when I get off this podcast. I'm going to go drive around and do the
echo. I don't do very well.
And this was, I think, released as a single. She actually had cut it previously in a studio session with the Seagull Schwall Band in Chicago. They booked some studio time. They were a local blues band. I had the privilege of interviewing Corey Siegel about the sessions, and, you know, they were all pretty amazed, but they came out with a sound that just was not Joni at all. Right. They were throwing in all sorts of stuff, and they did two or three different versions of Night in the City that are really strange, and she's totally disavowed those recordings.
I have to leave.
See you next time.
I guarantee you there's never going to be an archive with these recordings on them. But, of course, I have them. I wouldn't trade them for anything. And talking to PM Dawn, they actually did a cover of Night in the City.
Okay.
Yeah, straight up.
I know this is one of, you know, maybe one of Joni's simpler songs. It's not maybe the deepest one of the catalog. But there's just something about it that just, to be very simple, it just makes me feel good.
It's very joyous.
Yeah,
it is.
It makes me feel good, too. I like it. I've always loved it.
And I can easily get in the muck of emotion and get to that dark place. So to have a song that kind of lifts me up and makes me want to skip down the street, all right, a little bit, I'll take it.
I always felt that a yodel sound to it.
Yeah, sure.
Oh, yeah.
No, yeah, when she goes to that top note, yeah. Night in the city looks pretty to me.
And it's definitely the... Again, the lower voice on this song a little bit that isn't the helium voice. That, you know, it was kind of on this album, but I feel like it maybe wasn't on the next couple albums. It didn't come back till later, so. All right, any thoughts on Night in the City before we move on? All right, we move on to Marcy, which on the archive said, she tells it gives a beautiful introduction. This was written in England, correct?
Correct.
In about a friend of hers. I can't remember the story off the top of my head, so if anyone wants to jump in.
Mark probably knows it better than I do.
Well, I think she said that she just used the woman's name in the song. Okay. But she says something about she ran into this person in London, and she was trying to think up something to write about London. She said, I'm a songwriter, I'm in London, I should be writing about London. And then she ran into this woman named Marcy. I think they were playing some kind of a game or cards or something. And she ended up writing a song about Marcy. And it turned out that they had lived, I don't know, very close to
very close to each other, yeah.
Yeah.
In the States.
Yeah. Wherever it was. But I think she just used the name. And then she said, really, the song is about, it's probably about me. All my songs are about me.
Didn't she have a working title that was like something about the colors? Like
Portrait in Red and Green was the name of the title, the name of the song, and she would introduce it in many concerts. She'd introduce it as Portrait in Red and Green.
Right.
Yeah. That's the image, or the image, I don't know, colors that she uses throughout the song.
Red's for stop and green's for going, and she goes on and on. And Pearl, I'll say that, you know, Pearl and Steve named their daughter Marcy, so
Pearl's got really? Another song.
I was just going to say that.
That is amazing. Well, oh my gosh.
And I even told her that, too.
Yeah.
And she said to me, I was telling her I'd name my daughter Marcy, and she said, all the Marcy's in Chelsea's, they're all grown up now.
Yeah.
I love the line, Marcy's faucet needs a plumber, Marcy's sorrow needs a man. I can relate to that one. But
on the album, it's spelled Marcie, but in the book, I did M-A-R-C-Y, but in the book, the original spelling that she had was M-A-R-C-Y.
Oh, in the songbook.
Not in the songbook.
In her hand.
In the poet.
Oh, the
Morning Glory on the Vine.
In the Morning right. Glory on the Vine book, it's written M-A-R-C-Y. So I had forethought with that. That I said I didn't like the way it looked with Weisberg, the W M A R C I E W E I, you know, all that. So I made it M A R C Y, and that's how she originally had it. So I don't know who at the record company changed it.
That was a
beautiful. So Marcy was one of the demos when she went to England in 1967 to do a series of concerts. She had some demo tapes with her to try to market, you know, some mm-hmm. demo tapes to other artists. Fairport Convention, you know, probably most famously, that did a lot of those early songs, including mm-hmm. Marcy. The Johnstons also did a Marcy. So a lot of these early covers of Marcy came from this demo tape before she even released the album.
I didn't know Fairport did Marcy.
No. Uh-huh.
Had a lot of Fairport albums. So I'll have to look for that.
Yeah, I'd be interested to hear that myself. It's so interesting that even these early songs that maybe weren't even as popular as some of the other ones, like 40 versions of I Had a King. Like, I can't believe that. That shows how great all the songwriting is.
Yeah, I mean, most recently by a jazz trumpeter from the UK named Colin Steele put out a really good Joni tribute album. I Had a King is on that one. If you're a jazzer, those opening two melodic lines in I Had a King are just gorgeous. This is a gorgeous melody, you know. And that's one thing that's been interesting to find doing all my covers research is that as brilliant a lyricist as she is, her melodies are so strong that lots of people just gravitate to the melody. Right. You know, okay, the words are great, but I'm just gonna jump in and enjoy this melody and swim around in it because it's so original and sumptuous.
I really like the structure of her lyrics too. It was in the song. The different ways that she uses red and green, and the way she takes a concept kind of like clouds, you know, where she takes and then puts it in different context.
It's candy. First, it's candy that's sweet or sour. Then it's autumn or summer.
Red is stopping, green's for going.
The traffic lights. Angry or jealous.
Angry, red is angry, green is jealous. Yeah,
Dan, you gonna give us a rendition?
Cool. All right. Well, any thoughts on Marcy before we move on to the last track on side one?
Nathan.
Yeah. So Nathan LaFreniere, I remember the first time I heard this album. This song kind of scared me a little bit.
Yeah, well, it's got that
Banshee? Yeah. I didn't know what the hell that sound was.
This is a dark song. I'd say this is one of Joni's darkest songs.
Right.
Well, she used to perform this in conjunction with Marcy. It's kind of the sequel to Marcy.
So it's about London then? It's not New York City?
No. No, I don't think it's in that context, but But Marcy leaves and doesn't tell us. Well, this is Marcy leaving.
Okay.
LaFreniere. That's the impression I get anyway.
But it was actually autobiographical, right? I mean, she was getting a taxi to the airport, and the taxi driver's name was really Nathan LaFreniere.
Wow.
You know, they had the little card, ID card, on the front of the taxi. So she took a note of it, and I don't know if there was any kind of conflict or anything, but. You know, it was not apparently not a good taxi ride.
Yeah, this has to be New York City. He asked me for a dollar more. He cursed me to my face.
Yeah.
He hated everyone who paid to ride and share his common space.
The ghostly garden grows. There's your feel-good hit of the summer right there.
I spent many cab rides in New York City. Luckily, Nathan LaFreniere was not my taxi driver.
That's another one that has a lot of poetic language in it. Through the tunnel tiled and turning into daylight, once again I am escaping, once again goodbye.
Well, that's been that was really the fun part of this discussion list, right? I mean, she says, I saw an aging cripple selling Superman balloons. Mm-hmm. Why do you pick those words? Why do you pick those lyrics?
And
to not be able, especially with Hajira, I didn't have any friends who liked this record or even knew it. So I had nobody to talk to anybody about. So when the web first came into being and I realized there was a group of people around the world I can talk to Joni Mitchell about, oh my God, hell yeah, I'm going to sign up. How can I sign up? I need to do this. And then you discover all this other stuff and it's like, okay, well, and even to this day, Mark, you know, somebody will hit a line, you know, and it might just be a word. Like we talked about the word Fey, F-E-Y, in Fur, he sings the blues.
All right.
And we had a 2-day discussion just about that word. So, you know, these lines that, again, she writes, and there's some other songwriters that you read a lyric, it's like, okay, nobody else could write a lyric like that, you know. And Joni's not the only one that does it, but she does it probably more than anybody.
In full disclosure, Faye was one of the words that I went to the dictionary.
Yeah.
I need to look it up now.
Yeah, you know, sometimes songs write themselves, you know, and I'm looking at this, I can just see how it all kinds of flows. And I can, you know, like Graham Nash said that Our House, it all wrote itself, a series of things. Maybe it just seems like a cab ride, and then she saw, you know, a beggar in the street, and just expounded on that. It seems like it's very, I don't know what they're looking for, but like it almost wrote itself.
You definitely can tell the album's from 1968 because there's no little copyright symbol next to Superman.
Right.
What a haunting song. What other Joni songs do you think are quite, like, if you could do like her like top four darkest songs, like The Wolf That Lives in Lindsay, Nathan LaFreniere, like she has this, she gets really dark sometimes. And I feel like she didn't go there very often, but when she did, she really went.
Yeah. There. Well, you mentioned Beat of Black Wings, you know, that's a pretty dark song.
Yeah. I find The Priest to be a pretty dark song too.
Yeah. Yeah. Even down to you in terms of the whole sense of a one night stand and the solace and emptiness of that experience. You know, you brush against a stranger and you both apologize.
Yeah.
You know, that's maybe not darkness, but it's a real, real true sadness and emptiness.
And that instrumental passage in Down to You says almost as much as the lyrics do.
Oh yeah.
Which amazing. I feel like once we get to that one, we're going to be like, we just talked about the song for an hour.
Really? Block out some time.
Yeah. Well, do we have any thoughts on our friend Nathan LaFreniere before we flip over the record, theoretically?
Just only one comment, and I always throw in the cover stuff because it's, you know, interesting trivia that nobody but me kind of knows about or even cares about. But only hadn't been covered very much, as you can imagine. It's not a very song that people would flock to record. Most notably and initially by Rex Harrison's son, Noel Harrison, recorded it in 1968, the same year this album came out.
Really?
Yeah.
And how's his version?
You know, it's okay. It's a little different.
And one more thing about this song, I feel like Joni's voice almost sounds haunted in this one.
Oh yeah. Like,
her performance, I feel like she's singing from the cab. All right. Well, you flip over the record, and as it says, we are out of the city and down to the seaside. She must have gotten off the plane and gone right to Sisotobel Lane. It's interesting because when the guitar comes in, you really do feel like you're out of the city and down to the seaside. That little
start plinking. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I think it's really great that each side has a title.
Right.
You know, that she put that much thought into the song selection and order. You know, when everybody else was just putting the songs on LPs and shipping them out. You know, she is a concept album, kind of.
She didn't do that at any other album in her whole career, did she? Not off the top of my head, I can't think of.
No.
I know some of the later compilations like had a theme all the way through it, but that's what I loved about vinyl, is you could have two different experiences that were kind of standalone.
Yes.
With the CD, you didn't get that as much.
Of course, I had all her albums on vinyl, and I have them all on CD now.
Mm-hmm.
But including Night Ride Home, which she still released on vinyl in 1991.
I didn't know that came out on vinyl.
And I sought it out because I hadn't bought into this whole CD thing
yet. Right. So I had that little like special edition CD. They had like the four photograph prints inside.
Oh, I have that too.
Yeah. I have that too.
The Geffen box set.
Oh.
Is what that is.
All right. Well, Sisso Tobel Lane was never one of my favorite songs. It's a good song, but I think it sets the tone, it sets the theme. Does anyone have any thoughts about this one? I don't have too much to add.
Well, of course, Sisso Tobel means sometimes in spite of trouble, ours will be everlasting love. That's where that word comes from.
Yeah.
She invented her own mythology with, I've drawn a blank on the Pearl, help me out here. The two groups, sometimes we think we're little men and other times whatnot. Posol and Mosol. Mostly our souls are little men, and perhaps our souls are little ladies. Posol and Mosol. And she had actually a bootleg that was released with that name because she mentioned it, I think, on the radio interview she did in Philadelphia in 1967. That's where this name Sisso Tobel Lane comes from. And yeah, this is a song, as you said, Jeremy, she came to this record with a 75, 80 songs under her belt.
Mm-hmm.
Some of them not so good. Some of them great.
Right.
Some of them were forgotten and could have been huge hits, you know? So as much as I enjoyed this record, I think it was a misstep to try to put together a concept record instead of, as most artists would do, you've been out touring for a couple of years and you've got all these great songs. So I'm going to cull the best of my best and put out this record. Some of these songs she just had written, right? So yeah. She said, okay, this is fresh. So I want to record it.
She passed up the circle game for Sisso Tobel Lane.
And I don't know what this is about. It's been rumored. Of course, she gave up her child early on for adoption.
Right.
And, this was in some ways, maybe a fantasy of a home type situation where unwed mothers could be with their children, rocking on the front porch, that kind of thing. Yeah.
And we'll get to this album later, but sometimes I'm a little dense and I could not figure out for the life of me what Little Green was about.
I don't think anybody did. Nobody did at the time.
Okay. So it's not just me.
But it seems completely obvious now.
I'm like, why is this song on Blue? Like, all these other songs are so deep, and I just don't understand. And then when you find out what it's actually about, you're like, this is why this song is on Blue, okay.
And that she'd written it many years earlier.
Yeah,
many years earlier, yeah.
So
finally put it out on her fourth album.
Well, it's almost like, given that she put I Had a King on this record, why not put Little Green on there too? If you're going to be autobiographical, here's all, but it's got to be hard to put something like that out there knowing what it's about. Even though, Jeremy, like you said, I didn't know what it was about.
Right.
But to her, it was painfully obvious. And the memory was still very fresh on her mind, and in her heart.
Now, in an alternate universe, can you imagine the Song to a Seagull mix of Little Green with all the air? And I'm kind of glad
really.
For her fourth album.
No, I'm glad she did it when she did it.
Yeah.
It fit on Blue, obviously, because Blue was so emotionally powerful.
Yeah. Oh, no, I'm not going to second guess the song selection for Blue.
Sure.
When Little was written, I always assumed it was written that most of the songs in Blue were written.
Nope. Not about, I don't know, breaking up with Graham Nash.
Right.
Not James Taylor.
She's not in the cave in Paris.
Makes quite a contribution to Blue.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The conventional, excellent guitar playing is all James Taylor.
I love when James Taylor's guitar comes in.
Oh, James Taylor's an incredible guitar.
The first time I heard that album, like, his parts really made their mark. And we're such, like, we all love her music so much, we can't help but jump ahead. There's so much to talk about. So we will move on to the Dawn Treader. This song, like, you can feel the mist in the air. You can feel like the sea spray coming. And didn't she cover this song on her orchestra album, The Travel?
Yeah, she did. And if I can just step back real quick, about Sisso Tobel Lane covers, again, very rarely covered, but one of the most interesting ones, her friend Cass Elliott from Laurel Canyon days, did a studio recording of it, but it was never released until around the 2000 era, somebody dug these recordings out, put together an unreleased CD of Cass Elliott's with Sister Tobel Lane on it. And as you can imagine, it's beautiful.
Oh, wow.
Her voice on that song is so beautiful.
I'm going to make sure I get with you on the covers for every song before we move on to the next one. That has to be
okay. All right. I don't mean to hog anything.
No, I love it. I live for this stuff.
Well, it's the only reason it's so interesting is because, as I said earlier, Joni only had one hit. She never sold a lot of records.
Right.
So her money's been made from her publishing.
Right.
You know, that's where her money's been made. Hmm. So it's it's an honor for me to dig through all this and realize that, holy cow, you know, every December when all these people sit down and do River, you know, she's making bank.
Was her publishing company Crazy Crow and Sequoim or whatever?
It was Sequoim originally, which was another one of her mythology words.
Right.
She is queen of mind. She is queen undisputably of mind beauty.
Wow. So when I saw the track list for Travelogue and I saw the Dawn Treader was on there, I said, how's Joni Mitchell going to pull this off? But she did. I thought that was a great version of that song.
Beautiful song. And that's one of my favorites on that Travelogue project.
Yeah. And never in a million years did I think I'd hear a version of Dawn Treader. I can't do the math in my head, but was it 30, 40 years after it came out? And it was just blew me away.
Right.
I'm going to look at the lyrics here a little bit. It's been a little bit since I Perry Dots and Periwinkle Bloom It Down. So this, once again, like a lot of the lyrics on this album, it's very poetic.
Her knowledge of the colors is coming out.
Yeah. In this.
It's interesting. The Periwinkle, since 1986, we go on vacation at Pawleys Island, South Carolina. And the house that we stay in is called the Periwinkle.
Oh, I love it.
It's a shell. The periwinkle is a shell, you know, a beach shell.
And Bob, were you saying this was about David Crosby's boat?
Yeah, it was inspired by his boat, which I don't think was named, you know, it wasn't named Dawn Treader. It was something else. Maybe Pearl knows. I forget. There's so much trivia up there. Yeah. But it was just about that experience of being with him on his boat, on the water, you know, at the beach, and that whole sea experience.
I go to the beach. I live about 2 miles from the beach.
Wow.
And most mornings I'm out there taking sunrise pictures. And whenever I see the seagulls, of course, the lyric is in my head. You know, the fly silly seabird.
Right.
And she really captures the ocean. She captures the beach and the seagulls and the birds flying and the flotsam and jetsam or whatever with the water.
Yeah.
She's great.
Originally copyrighted as a song called Sea Dreams was what she copyrighted it as until she changed the name of it when the record came out.
Really?
Yeah.
I didn't know. Was there any covers of this song?
There's been quite a few. Yeah, quite a few. I don't have, for some reason, the website's not pulling up the numbers for me, but I want to say there's probably 15 or 20 of them. Okay. They're all really nice. It's such a pretty song. You know,
yeah.
Nobody really does much to it except sing it the way that it is.
Well, it doesn't really need much, to be honest with you.
No, doesn't need anything to it. And it's a long song; it's about 5 minutes long.
And that's where she gets in her lower voice.
Yes,
my dreams with the seagulls fly out of reach, out of cry. She gets low there. She gets high and low.
All right, so let's move on to the Pirate of Penance. And before we talk about it, when you're in the car singing along, are you Penance Crane or are you the dancer? It depends on my
mood. I'm neither. I'm neither because I don't like this song in any way, shape, or form. I hate
it. I've skipped this a lot.
No, I like a little drama in my life. I can be a little dramatic sometimes. So, you know, I have a little Penance Crane in me, I will admit. But she has no other song like this in her catalog, which maybe that's a good thing from the vibe I'm getting on this discussion. It's just
She wrote, it was interesting because she wrote Gift of the Magi based on the O. Henry song, which right. I think is on the archives a couple of times, where it's this whole, okay, I'm going to sing the whole song myself, but there's actually different characters. It calls for a chorus. It calls for a male lead. It calls for a female lead, but I'm going to be singing all those things. And this is kind of that song too, right? And obviously Pirate of Penance, a play on the Gilbert and Sullivan Pirates of Penzance show. But I never liked this and still don't like it.
It's definitely different, I guess is what we can say. What happens? Someone runs off with a dancer. It's been a little bit since I heard it. I know there's...
I don't know. I mean, I wish Mark was still here because we had a discussion about 10 years ago about this song. He likes it. You know, I said, to me, there's no discernible story that I can follow or get into. But he says, oh, yeah, the story's very clear. This girl, that, and, you know, she comes back and the pirates does this. And it's like, you know, I don't know. Again, to me, you've got 70 songs probably that are much stronger than this one. You just write it, but why did you put it on your first album? You know, yeah, give it a road test first.
If he can get back in, I'd love for him to come back in and tell us.
I would too. Yeah. 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 He's a good authority.
Can you imagine being Joni Mitchell and thinking like, I'm going to pass up Chelsea Mooring and release Pirate of Penance.
Right. Indeed. Or Circle Game, yeah. You know, all these songs that were audience favorites where she could have easily released a single and had us hit, but that's Joni, you know.
Yeah.
She confounds us at every turn.
Did she do this song live much?
She never did it live, as far as I know.
She never did it live.
Oh. It's been recorded. I mean, it's been covered one time by a French jazz artist who did the did it instrumentally.
Oh.
So skipped all the words, of course, because you know you just couldn't do it. It's like, you know, it's rat-a-tat singing that, you know, only the most skilled operetta singer could do.
The lyrics are like actually attributes the lines like the dancer, penance yeah, green. So I guess on this chat, I'm the one that likes the song the most. That's yeah. Not one of my favorites.
But, you like it more than me.
Yeah, I did have some fun sing-alongs in my car. I will admit it. I hope no one saw me. All right, so we move on to the title track. Oh,
singing Joni in the car makes the trip go a lot faster.
Oh, yeah.
You know.
Singing Joni always makes life better, no matter where you are. All right, so Song to a Seagull, the title track of the album. That's another song that you can just feel like the sea coming right on your, you know, washing right over you.
Musically and lyrically, you know.
Yeah. And I remember I had this on the CD. That last strum is mixed so high that even when you have the CD kind of quieter, like that last chord just jumps right out of the speaker.
Whoa!
Yeah. I remember once, like, it scared me. I'm like, whoa.
Yeah, I don't like that, personally. I think it should have been...
Yeah.
More quietly. But the thing I don't like about Night in the City is it's so much louder than all the other songs.
Right.
Now, maybe that was her intent, or David Crosby's, but David Crosby was not a really good engineer, now, was he?
No.
He'll admit it.
We can all agree on that one, right? Was this song specifically written for this album to meet the theme? Like, I wonder if the theme came first or the song came first.
The song came first. It was a fairly early song. Dan, I don't know if you have any specific knowledge, but she played this one in a lot of concerts early on.
Okay.
And when I say early on, I'm talking like 67, you know, when she was really on the road, coffee houses, whatnot, playing all the time.
Playing all her songs all the time and having yet to record.
Yeah.
That's what was so amazing to Crosby, was how is it that she hasn't been recorded yet?
Like on the archives, isn't there a point where she's like, oh, this is a new song I wrote a couple days ago, The Circle Game, or Both Sides Now.
Both Sides Now, in the airplane.
And they're always different than the way they end up. I mean, she experiments constantly. I mean, everything is improvised with her.
Well, she comes up with a tuning, and she'll write a couple of different songs in that tuning. You know, for instance, going back to Michael from Mountains, that was a guitar tuning that she also did Dr. Junk, the Dentist Man.
I like that song. It's a
fun little song.
Yeah.
You know, you got to play a little Bo Diddley crowd pleaser stuff if you're doing some live stuff, you know.
So since we're sitting here doing this, since we don't know yet, how do you think the archive series is going to progress? Do you think the other sets will be as extensive as this first one we got? I know we have like some Hissing of Summer Lawns demos that were out, but I'm curious of like what's really sitting in her trunk there.
Yeah, I'm really curious. You know, I mean, in the last 20 something years, I've done some extensive trading with a lot of people around the world and kind of picked a lot of stuff that was out there. Matter of fact, about half of what came out on the archives was stuff that I already had.
Sure.
But it was really cool to have a lot of stuff that wasn't, you know, that had just been discovered. And Joel Bernstein, who's her guitar, you know, guitar expert and art and formal archivist, has, you know, access to lots and lots and lots of things. So I don't know what he's holding. You just don't know what's out there. You know, she didn't seem to have a lot of songs that she recorded but didn't use, you know.
Right.
One song that I can think of that was never on any albums was Urge for Going. I think that was on the flip side of a single.
Yeah, You Turn Me On.
You Turn Me On, I'm a Radio.
Yeah.
I think it was that one time going to be on Blue.
Right. Hunter.
But she wrote that song really, really early on.
Yeah.
I think she actually sang it in that TV show from Canada.
Hmm. And of course, it was a huge hit for Tom Rush.
Sure.
Right. Yeah, Tom Rush. In fact, I'm in this group, Obscurest Song of the Day, and I posted that song, and people were amazed that Tom Rush didn't write that song.
Okay.
Sorry, Bob. One more thing about Urge for Going. Chuck Mitchell, who, of course, was living with her at the time when she wrote a lot of these songs, said, you know, she would sit down and she could write a song in an hour, she's done. Okay, move on to the next song. But she had an Urge for Going. She toiled over it, rewrote it, scratched out phrases, changed things around. She spent a long, long time writing that song. And she said, this is the first really good song I've ever written.
And that song feels
that's
like
where I learned the word chevron.
Oh, yeah.
The birds.
When that song finally appeared on that Hits CD.
Yeah,
I think that's the opening track.
The first time, I think that was the first time I ever heard it. And I was just blown away by it. I thought, this is the most beautiful thing. Why didn't she ever put this on an album?
It smells of Canada, doesn't it?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. Much. Down the prairie.
So, Mark, since we have you back, it's been discovered that you and I are the only ones that like Pirate of Penance. The rumor has it that you do like the song. So what? I think it's dramatic and very weird. I ask everybody when they're in the car if they're singing the dancer part or Penance Crane, and everyone said neither.
Well, to me, it sounds like it belongs in the 19th century or even the 18th. I don't know.
At an unfair.
there's a bit of a mystery there. I don't know. She's playing. There's two different characters with that ghostly sound of the dancer in the background, and I've always liked Pirate of Penance.
The rest of us are ready to move on.
So you're not finished with Song of the Seagull yet? My machine is having major issues there. So,
well, you're always, you know, if you jump off, feel free to just keep coming back. do we have any other thoughts? I guess we're done. We'll move on from Pirate of Penance. I guess we're done with her. But do we have any other thoughts on Song to a Seagull?
Well, again, with the covers, Buffy St. Marie did the first cover of this in 1967, prior to Joni's recording of it. And it's been covered by several jazz artists. Paul Desmond did a recording of it. And then most interestingly, in 2016, a Polish artist, Monica Borzym, did a Joni tribute where she recorded every song in Polish language, including Song to a Seagull. Fascinating record, really good record.
Every song.
It's been recorded 22 times. So, you know, it's a beautiful song.
The line about my gentle relations have names they must call me for loving the freedom of all flying things. I don't know. To me, there's a kind of a thread that runs up throughout her music about flight and about flying. I mean, there's Amelia on Hegira and Black Crow and
Beat of Black Wings,
yeah, and Don Lund's Reckless Daughter. There's the
eagle imagery.
The eagle and the serpent, yeah. So I think she has something about imagining flight or whatever.
And it all ends up on over on Airport Road with in Ray's dad's Cadillac.
You can see, and of course, this song has the line, I came to a city, which was the subtitle for the side of the album.
Right. Yeah, I always felt like it was written when she was living in New York. That was the feel that I got from the song. I have no idea whether that's true or not. In Chelsea and the cobble streets and some of the downtown areas over there.
Yeah.
I don't know.
I've always kind of wondered what her first experience with an ocean or a large body of water was. If it was in New York or
on a vacation or something.
What's that?
Or in David Crosby's boat.
Yeah, that's what I can say. Crosby's boat down in Florida.
Yeah.
But Alberta or, Saskatchewan is very landlocked.
Yeah.
Trust there's no beaches.
No.
No surfing in Saskatchewan.
No.
And when she was living up there as a child, I was a child in northern North Dakota.
Well, I came from Iowa, which is not quite as horrible as that, but the winters can be pretty severe there, too.
Yes.
All right. Agreed. So the album ends with a song that I consider to be epic. Like, I think Cactus Tree is just a masterpiece.
I agree.
100% agree.
Maybe I feel the best song on the album. Like, I like this album. It's kind of a weird debut album, but I feel like Cactus Tree really takes it to the next level and shows what Joni's really capable of.
The driving rhythm of the guitar riff, it's a bass line, which is so unusual, going from the tonic to the major seventh, if you know what I mean.
And even the opening line. I'll go ahead.
Oh, I was going to say this theme of needing autonomy as it comes into tension or
repeated
conflict with this need for romantic love or companionship or whatever it is, it runs throughout her entire life and her music.
Right. It's here. It's in Help Me off the top of my head.
Oh, Coyote.
Coyote.
Gyra.
Why do I keep
of the highway?
Yeah, I think Cactus Tree really shows us where Joni Mitchell is going to take us over the rest of our entire lives, honestly. I mean, I think once we all got hooked, there's no turning back. And for me, no other artist can give me what Joni Mitchell gives me. Like, I have different singers that I love, but there's a certain piece that's only Joni's piece.
And this would have been a new song that she brought into the studio with her to record.
Okay.
Obviously experiencing, being on the boat with Crosby and just reflecting on relationships that she'd had over the past couple of years with different kinds of men.
Right.
And so this is one of those songs where, yeah, I just wrote this, but I know it's damn good.
Right.
And I think it reflects a cultural shift. I mean, up until that point, of course, things were changing in 1968 and how we viewed sexuality and so forth, but women were not supposed to have multiple lovers. That wasn't something, that was supposed to happen.
Right.
At least not when I was a kid. Of course, the men
write songs either. About you called Runaway, what was it?
Runaway Sue?
Yeah.
Runaround Sue?
Runaround Sue, yeah. Right. And the flip side of that was I'm a Wanderer. So it was okay.
With the man, it was you were sowing your wild oats, but the woman, no.
The man's a hero, the woman's a tramp, right?
Well, yeah,
right,
exactly.
That's how she broke her, she had such a long-running feud with Rolling Stone.
Oh, they had the chart.
They published a two-page diagram of all the men she had relationships with, and they called her the Queen of L.A., E-L-L-A-Y.
Oh, that's
an old lady of the year as well.
Yeah. So it's okay for men to have a million groupies, you know, but for this woman to be, you know, to have multiple partners, no, it's just unforgivable. So
I feel like in 2021, that still exists partially, I think.
Oh, sure. Oh, it's not totally gone.
I'm sure.
Well, because we're turning back. I think, I don't want to get into the.
Yeah.
Probably a better not.
Although I would imagine we probably mostly all feel the same way.
We're all on the same ground. That's the nice thing about the Joni Mitchell list, you know.
Yeah. I would imagine so, everybody.
Yeah.
But
we're breathing a big sigh of relief this week.
Oh,
I'm loving this discussion happening after yesterday. It's like two great things in a row. If anyone wants to give this video a thumbs down, have at it. I don't care. I'm not ashamed. But looking at this song in the context of 1968, this was a ballsy song to list off all these men. You know, if we're singing with Joni, she'd be like, well, that was Eric. That was George. Like, she could just sit there and.
I used to like to play that one a lot.
Yeah, yeah. I think I've heard you play it, Pearl.
You heard me play that one?
I think okay. So, yeah.
Okay.
She will love them when she sees them. They will lose her if they
follow.
She only means to please them, and her heart is full and hollow like a cactus tree. That was quite a statement.
So, yeah, and as far as specifics, you know, obviously that whole first verse is about Crosby.
Yeah.
The only one that I can point out specifically is the man who sends her medals bleeding from the war.
That's Killer Kyle, isn't it? Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
Have been
she
Killer
met
Kyle.
In Fayetteville, Fort Bragg at Fayetteville in 1967, where she played a concert there. And he came backstage and talked to her. And it was probably a very early, early version of post-traumatic stress syndrome, you know, and it wasn't diagnosed back then, but he gave her all these medals, said, you know, I don't need these. They don't mean anything to me. I've had this bad experience, and told about all the things that happened with his girlfriend and stuff. So this was an early version of the Killer Kyle story in two lines.
And she has said that during the Vietnam War protest, she thought it was wrong to blame the soldiers. And of course she was right. I mean,
oh yeah.
That should never have happened, and it caused a lot of anger and resentment still in Vietnam War veterans, which they're probably entitled to some degree. But she said she didn't believe that, so she would play places like Fort Bragg. Mm-hmm. I can talk, of course I can.
which it's called Fort Bragg now, but that name is soon going to be changed.
Yeah. It's a good thing.
Yeah, sure, it's a good thing. It's all good.
Oh, it's all good, isn't it?
Yep.
I don't feel that way, but go ahead.
Yeah. And that's good, too. That's good that we all have our own.
You know, I'm miserable over yesterday, so.
Are you?
Well,
yes.
Well, that's the thing.
My worst nightmares, but aww. Go ahead.
Sorry to make assumptions, Pearl.
Yeah.
Yes.
Pearl, we're all one family here with Joni Mitchell, so.
That's fine. Well, if you love Joni Mitchell, you could be, you know, you're absolutely free to be whatever you want to be.
Absolutely.
Or believe.
So apologies for making assumptions, but, you know, we always grow, we learn and grow, and here we are. I love it. So do we have any thoughts on Song to a Seagull before we wrap this one up?
It was a stunning debut.
That
album, you know, shaped a lot of my life and my taste in music, and you know, my introduction to Joni. It was 1968. I was 15, something like that. She's been the most important influence in my life, musically, lyrically. There's always a Joni line for every thing that you do in your life. There's a Joni line that comes into your head.
Yeah.
a lyric.
Looking at Cactus Tree covers, not too long ago, it was Judy Collins did it, a duet with Sean Colvin, which as you can imagine is quite beautiful. Yeah. That was on her album, Bohemian. Chava Alberstein, recorded it in Hebrew, Pearl.
Oh, okay. I don't speak Hebrew, but go ahead.
Well,
yeah, Yiddish. I can speak Yiddish, but not Hebrew.
So it's been recorded about 40 times. You know, there's not a real There's not a Both Sides Now cover on this record, where Both Sides Now, of course, is 1,500, 1,600 times.
Wow.
But every song on this record has been recorded, and you can't say that about all of her albums.
Okay.
Well, I said I came to her with Court and Spark, and I was in college at the time, and at the University of Northern Iowa in Cedar Falls, Iowa. And there was one record store near the campus that was actually a head shop and a record store, Cloudburst mm-hmm. Records. And so for a long time, I thought Clouds was her first record. I didn't even know this album existed. And then I took a course in the art department, and while we were working on some of our projects, the instructor would play Joni Mitchell albums. And one of them was Song to a Seagull, and it was the first time I'd ever heard it. And finally, it turned up in Cloudburst, and I grabbed it. And I've been in love with this record ever since. It's one of my very favorites.
It's interesting, because back then, before the internet, you really didn't know an artist's discography all the time.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
You had to go out and search for it, and you know, maybe you'd find a book that listed things, but if you didn't have that book, you might be at a yard sale and find a record you never knew existed.
Mm-hmm.
I miss that a little bit, to be honest with you. Like that treasure hunt.
Absolutely.
What was Khaki's favorite album?
For the Roses. Yeah, For the Roses, no doubt.
For some reason, title couldn't come into my head for a second.
That's our age, Pearl.
Well, for sure. I'm sitting here thinking, what's the album where she's sitting on the, you know, in the grass with the boots on and whatever? And it wouldn't come to me, but it's.
Yeah, we'll get to that one.
That and Court and Spark.
I'm going all the way to Shine. So I loved talking with all of you. I feel like we have a great panel right here. Of course, if y'all know anybody that wants to join, they're welcome. But I probably won't another call.
I invited 20 people.
Yeah.
I invited 20 people to this from my list of things that I have on my Joni in my Facebook Joni people. And
well, it was great to have Dan here to talk about the you know, the guitar work on some of these records. And if Sue McNamara or I guess Sue Tierney could be on this, you know, it would be invaluable.
I invited Sue Tierney.
Dave Blackburn.
Yeah, and Dave Blackburn.
Yeah.
I'm looking at Tuesday, February 16th to do Clouds. So if that doesn't work for anybody, I can switch the day. You know what I mean? I really enjoyed talking with this group, so I'm pretty flexible. I just want to talk music.
Yeah, I'm retired. I don't care.
We'll keep the politics out of it. Let's stick with Joni Mitchell.
That's fine.
Tuesdays are most days are good. You know, with COVID, I don't have a lot of alternative plans.
Yeah.
This was a really nice respite.
Well, thank you. Any final thoughts on Song to a Seagull before I do the wrap up?
Can't think of anything.
It's awesome. What can you say? All right.
Amazing.
Well, thank you all. I feel like I made some new friends today, which I love. And I had so much fun talking about Song to Seagull. If you are on YouTube, make sure to like the Phonogenics 101 podcast. And I'll be making this live either tonight or tomorrow. So I'll send it to everybody.
Okay. Okay. I'm sorry. I wasn't more alert here today.
I missed my favorite song.
Oh, what song?
The Dawn Treader.
Go.
Oh.
Throw in some thoughts.
I don't know. There's just always been something about that song that I just absolutely loved. The melody, the guitar, the words, all of it. It's one of my absolute favorite songs by Joni Mitchell or anybody else.
And we did talk about how that cover version, when she revisited it, how it was so good all those years later.
Oh, the orchestration, it comes out of her guitar work.
Yeah.
Almost completely. It's beautiful.
All right. Well, thank you to all my Patreon subscribers and to all my Joni Mitchell friends here. And you will see us all in February to talk about Clouds. I can't wait.
Clouds. Okay.
Have a great night, everybody. Nice to meet you all.
Good night, everybody.